Welcome back on theCUBE's live coverage of AWS reInvent 2025. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. It's our 13th year covering reInvent. We've seen the evolution of Amazon Web Services and cloud from abstracting away servers and infrastructure to building higher level services. But now that the ground is changing, but the game is still the same, abstracting away data and work, you're seeing agents really starting to form the next view of this next level of value. Back on theCUBE as a tradition, Swami's back. Head of Agentic AI for AWS. Great to see you.
Hey, glad to be back.
I love to see you in the hallways here. I just grab you, pull you in. That's called the hallway grab in theCUBE vernacular. Thanks for coming on.
Oh, no, my pleasure.
So keynote today, smashing, again, all in on agents.
We
saw each other at the HumanX conference as well. What has progressed in your mind? Because this year, three things jump out at me. One, the AI factories positioning.
Yeah.
Basically speaks to the large scale infrastructure. Great, check the box. Trainium 3, better performance. We're seeing all the industry on the CapEx side. But the NovaForge and the Frontier agents really jumps off the page as a game changer. Explain why that's so important and why now.
To me, first, Agentic AI, in my mind, is going to be one of the biggest technology transformation in the history of tech. And to that end, at AWS, we are building for the foundation for the future of billions of agents operating in the next few years. And to me, that is an understatement. There are going to be a lot more. So now in such a world, what does it mean for us to prepare? And that is really one of the reasons why we are investing in frontier agents, because we want to reinvent how software development is done in the world. And if you see the history of what is going on, and when I say history, this is literally past 18 months in the space on software development assistance and
it's the opening agents. It's the opening act of Gen AI.
Exactly, right? And but so much as focus has been only around writing code. And but if you see what is happening in a true enterprise or anywhere, it is like 20 to 30% of what a developer does. They end up spending a lot of time on DevOps and dealing with on-call and SRE work. They end up on security and upgrades and various other tests and pen testing and whatnot. So to some extent, we did not do enough to give them the freedom to ideate and create. And so we asked ourselves saying like, let's reinvent this whole discipline and come up with virtual agentic teammates. So initially, even moving beyond vibe coding, first we started with creating Kiro, which is our agentic IDE, where we said, no longer do you just need to do vibe code. Let's actually use agents to create specifications on what you're trying to accomplish, and then build ideas, our design, and then create code and write tests. So this led to this whole transformation where you saw Matt talked about how we had like a team of six engineers build this whole inference thing. What could have taken us like 30 to 40 people for 1 year, we got it done in like 76 days. That is like an example of suddenly we just changed the game. But then based on that experience, we learned something. He said, you know what? Why actually, even in many cases, you need humans to steer? Why can't we have agentic teammates come in? And that led to frontier agents at Kiro autonomously planning. And DevOps agent is taking care of on-call and prior to SRE. And then you have actually with security agent doing pen testing and design and everything. So this is going to be a step change in productivity where you're not talking about 20 to 30% gain. We are talking about 5X to 10X.
I love Matt's line. I want to get your thoughts because you just kind of hinted at it. Agents stop being toys. They become teammates. One of the things I in the Kiro pre-interviews I did, the thing that jumped out at me was it learns your preferences, like how you document certain the nuances of teams.
That's right.
Like certain teams have know, particulars
that
they like certain things the way they are.
And they are very opinionated about it.
So, of course, it's easy to yell at an agent. There's no hostile work environment there. But, I mean, talk about why the teammates thing is so important because that makes it personal.
Yeah.
That makes it fun.
Yeah.
and makes it productive.
That's right. To some extent, the key thing with these agents showing up as teammates is because then they learn your code bases, they learn your preferences, and then they have built-in write memory so that they even know, for instance, like, hey, this team actually ends up coding up with this style, even as down as what is the preference on how they like to do code review, to what are the ways they like to upgrade particular thing, what is their favorite databases to whatnot. And then they starts building context and brain end to end so that it doesn't ask dumb question. The problem right now with most AI assistants are that they always act more like an intern instead of a very tenured teammate within the company. So that means every day is like day one and you keep training the intern.
Yeah, and DevOps, they talk about day two operations. Your DevOps frontier agent essentially is a day two operations engineer.
That's
on call.
That's exactly right. And it actually is not just an on-call engineer, but it also has another, I call it the cousin of an SRE agent, which does proactive SRE work. Yeah. And so when you think about that one, them showing up in Teams Slack and saying, like, when I used to get paged, when I was a principal engineer, I still get paged and incidents happen. But when I was on call as an engineer, if I wake up at 2 a.m. in the morning, earlier, I used to be the one debugging the metrics and logs and everything else, and we still did. But now with DevOps agent, we have the possibility of it first engaging at the same time so that by the time I log onto the computer, now it can notify me on Slack saying, like, I did all the background work, so here is most likely the root cause.
It's like a chef. You have a sous chef. They chop the vegetables, and everything's ready for you. So you're ready to go.
That's right.
You know, you mentioned earlier that you guys really had a vision to transform the software development lifecycle.
That's right.
And this is one of the motivations. You and I have talked about this in the past. Now it's on stage in the keynotes. This applies not only to building apps, but to also doing other things. I saw the display on Monday, I think it was, where you dropped blew up a legacy system.
Yeah.
I don't know which one it was, but, you know, migrations is in the agenda. I mean, I saw the key, like, migrations, what the hell? I mean, that's like, that's top line story. But the point is, that's still software.
That's right.
So that, again, so the software reinvention could apply to migrations. It could apply to code reviews, it could apply to everything.
To me, migrations arguably is one of the most tedious things that is really slowing down every company to reinvent them. This modernization, being stuck in mainframes or like expensive .NET licenses and or what's going on at VMware and so forth. Let alone even things like, you know what, I need to upgrade from V1 of this library to V2 or go need to move from Perl to Java and whatnot. So this is why when I started this new organization, I said, you know what, let's make modernization cool again by making it agentic. Yeah. Let's actually change the game by doing it order of magnitude faster. So that's why mainframe migration no longer is like this 3 to 4 year thing. Yeah. It is like now done in months and for the mainframe part. And same is true for like this custom transformation. So when I was talking to Julia, I'm then saying like, you know, this is really profound transformation that you need to showcase in a way. And Julia came up with this brilliant idea of let's blow up technical debt. And I'm like, yes, that's what we are doing. She said, no, you got to actually literally blow up. And I was like, holy shit, that was fun.
That was fun. It was awesome. And it's very showy, but it makes the point.
Exactly.
Most migrations have been months.
Yeah.
And it's tedious. It's grinding.
Yeah.
And now you can literally clone and create like digital twins. There's now a big movement from some of the advances that you guys announced where people are looking at code bugs, fixing them fast. We're going to meet a bunch of folks here on theCUBE. I just saw a company get funding. They're doing a simulation and essentially pre-vetting code before it even goes into GitHub. So you're starting to see kind of new techniques.
That's right.
Are there things that you see that are going to come out of this? And one other observation I'll share with you and get your thoughts on is, there's more data coming off these agents too, because there's telemetry and there's you know, a vector embed has more data than just words. So now that's more storage. So there, how do you view that, and what does the infrastructure need to do? Obviously, Trainium's got advances, tokens per to watt is a metric. There's more data coming in,
yeah.
And the budgets aren't necessarily going up as much.
Yeah.
So, I think pre-agentic, the budget, the data growth was like 30 to 40% CAGR.
Yeah.
Now it's going to probably be hundreds.
Yeah. I think, so that's a great question, especially in a world where more and more agentic workflows are going to happen. Many thinking problems are becoming compute and data problems. So that means fundamentally, you continue to drive down efficiencies on both the compute and how we store data and how these agents are getting built. So that's why things like investment in Trainium, let alone what we have done in the vector industry with S3 vectors and OpenSearch are game changers, along with now with things like Agent Core, how we are able to build these short-term and long-term memories and episodic memories. Yeah. So now think of what we have done with like Transform Custom. When we are upgrading 100,000 repos, then suddenly we can learn what worked in one repo and what failed, and then we can apply it in a different context on the, let's say, the 1,001st repository. So then that means this agent is continuously learning. So it gets better fast, really quick, after a first 10.
And that's between a frontier agent versus, say, a regular agent.
That's exactly
it's almost
right.
Like LLMs before, they had frontier capabilities.
That's right.
Which was multi-step reasoning, et cetera. Right. I have to ask you on the intelligence side, if you look at, say, Agent Core, you got memory, identity gateway, browser tools, observability, drift detectors, policy enforcement, natural language. It's all in there. But also, Strands made it back to the main stage again.
Yeah.
So last time we talked, you were bragging about Strands being an internal project and proud of it. That has become quite the product.
Yeah.
What is Strands now versus when it evolved?
What, I know.
Because it's come into, I interviewed Claire Ligorio in Seattle. She was proud mom of that product.
That's right.
But where is Strands in the scheme of the agents? What's the role of Strands?
I think Strands is one of the amazing invention. Claire is one of the big pioneers for it, which really came from an era where you say, hey, in this world where LLMs have this amazing reasoning capabilities, how we build agents can be done remarkably in a simple manner. So she and a couple of, literally two others, built this framework to build things like Kira. And then we saw so much that where we were able to delete thousands of lines of code and get better accuracy with this framework. And I still remember, she actually messaged me, I think this was sometime in summer at 7 o'clock in the morning, saying like, this is so impactful that we think it is better, and she thought it was better that we open sourced it so that all AWS customers, let alone everybody in the industry, could actually build better agents and it will move the industry forward. She said, so we should open source it. So literally, I think 3 hours later, Claire and I and Mark Brooker and a few of us met, and we decided, they wrote like a one-pager on pros and cons, and we said, okay, after that meeting, we decided we should. And that evening, I met with Matt for like 15 minutes, and Matt said, okay, let's do it. And then we open-sourced the day after. That is literally how fast we moved. Then fast forward to now, it is by default, people are able to leverage Strands to build agents in such a breathtaking phase, like what you saw with Cox Automotive to what you're seeing with several others, and what you saw with like Blue Origin and whatnot. So now what we are seeing is essentially that who can build agents is changing so fast. No longer do you need all this complex orchestration logic. And it is taking off at like 5 million downloads in such a short time. And the pace at which this is getting used is also accelerating month over month. So with so many community contributions and whatnot.
All right, so I have to ask you, because I asked a bunch of other folks this question too. This reInvent seems to be one of those moments for AWS where the ground's shifting. But the game is still the same. You got infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and now AI native apps. I interviewed Eshwar on container native.
Yeah.
So you got now the Kubernetes piece, cloud native, and AI native coming together. What do you expect to change after this reInvent? What do you expect to see? People are already enthusiastic about agents.
Yeah.
Is it going to be more confidence? Is it going to be more unlock at the enterprise? What do you see as the next chapter that will come out of this reInvent?
Well, I'm tempted to say you should wait till next year reInvent to see. But I would say in many ways, what changes, while it's a very important question, a more important question is going to be what's not going to change primarily. And for that, people are going to actually want agents that they can rely on and they can actually find it trustworthy. And that it solves them problem that takes care of undifferentiated heavy lifting. Well, we are starting to see, and many of the innovations that I touched on today and Matt touched on, is laying the foundations. You're going to see who can build an agent is going to change fundamentally. That means every app nowadays has a compute, storage, database, and some AI backed in. But every app by next year is going to be agentic. And that is going to be a given in my mind.
That's the next era.
And that means the world is about to shift where it is going to be completely agentic driven, and it is going to be the new normal, and that's what we are empowering.
Swami, great to have you on. Again, congratulations on a great keynote. I know you worked hard, the team. Love the speed of the transformation. Love the rethinking.
That's awesome.
And you know, Matt used an example with Reddit.
Yeah.
Domain expertise is huge in these agents.
That's right.
So speak quickly about the domain-specific nature of why that's important, because this is where you got the MCP, A2A, you got the multiple frameworks, including Strands. This choice now to code anything up, whether it's Nova or another model in Bedrock, SageMaker has now bidirectional support for audio through DeepGram. We interviewed them. A lot of other innovators are coming into the system, and it's a systems architecture.
Yeah. I mean, domain expertise is super important in this new world. The nice thing in this agentic world is that you can bring in your domain expertise in multiple layers of the stack. Yes, you can bring it in as APIs that you bring in through MCP, as you pointed out, and you can integrate it directly with even out-of-the-box tools like Cook Suite and bring in your own MCP too. You can also enable it with developers and build it through Agent Core. And of course, you can go the one layer deeper with the model level and customize it using tools like NovaForge and everything. It is because at the end of the day, the way I think about domain expertise is every business has to think about what is the core underlying value and asset that they have and how they would like to leverage it and integrate with everybody else. And for many, it is about like, how do I convert my SaaS and API business and expose it with other agents? So that's why they're exposing it as MCP and A2A tools. Yeah. And for others, it is about like, I would love to build my own frontier model. Yeah. And that is where things
start. Generic reasoning doesn't work in these domains.
That's right.
Matt said, I'll end the quote here, generic tokens are useless unless they know your business.
That's right.
That's where agents shine.
That's right.
You agree with that?
That's right.
Swami, great to have you on. I know you're super busy. Thank you for spending the time to come into theCUBE and our annual tradition.
I missed
you in Seattle. Thanks for spending the time and sharing your insights.
No, my pleasure. Thanks for having me, and hopefully we get to do it again.
We'll be here next year. If not, our agents will be here working on our behalf. I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. Thanks for watching.